Okay, we'll just get started. Okay, how many people have been here before? When was the last Perspectives? I think Barcelona, maybe? Anyone? Okay, yeah, so probably about half the room. It is so good to be back. My name is Steve Willite, and I have the privilege of leading the global organization, global team for the sustainability business for Schneider Electric. With me today on stage is my good buddy, Pasha. Pasha is relatively new, so I fully expect all of you to give him as much grief as you've given me in the past, all right? So this is gonna be good banter back and forth here today. But Pasha joined us from Accenture a few months ago and leads all our client activity across EMEA. And so we are really glad to have him today here as well. So he and I are gonna be doing a little bit of tag team as we go through this discussion this morning. So Pasha, I can give you a second to say hello.
Sounds good. Well, it's a privilege to be here. As Steve mentioned, I joined Schneider a couple of months ago. I spent over a decade and a half in sustainability consulting, so I'm a recovering management consultant, I like to say. It's gonna take me some time, but it's really good to be here. It's a great pleasure because over time, as I've worked and advised customers on sustainability strategy and what we need to do, I realized that more often than not, those really slick PowerPoint decks end up on the table and the implementation is the one that's a bit of a crapshoot. So we really need to lean in and get things done, which is change the color of electrons that are going through entire end-to-end value chain of our customers. And this, where at Schneider, is where the magic happens. So really excited to be here. Thanks, Steve.
So thanks, Pasha. So, whoa, it feels like I got louder even then. If I'm coming right through your living room too loud, just give me one of those and they'll adjust the sound. So anyway, it is good to be here. If you think about it, our lives are completely different than when we were together before. And had a chance to share over dinner last night with a few folks. I'm actually going to be referring to that dinner a few times. But what we find ourselves in is a completely different stage of life. And so what we want to do over the course of today is there's going to be different breakout sessions and opportunities for you to get in and not just network, but hear from different leaders, hear from some other clients that we have or other companies that to share some of their experiences. But this is our first in-person, face-to-face event here in Europe, post-pandemic, if I can use that phrase. But the world has gone completely upside down during that time. And so we want to talk just bluntly about some of that here today and some of the challenges that we faced. So we've all faced this pandemic challenge unprecedented fashion. And again, we were talking a little bit about this last night and the way we've had to address this, not just at our work, but in our families, in our homes, in our communities, and things have completely changed upside down for all of us. So it's good. In fact, when I walk up and have seen some of you, I have to say, did we meet in person, on video, or is this brand new, or have I seen some photo? And half the time, as Tom just said a minute ago, hey, I've seen your videos. And then I have to apologize and say, I hope it wasn't too shiny, you know, while you were looking at it. But we have seen unprecedented economic turmoil here in the context of COVID, all of us. And all of us have experienced it both personally, around the table last night, and actually I've done this with my team, spend an evening going around the room, as we did in one of our first team meetings just a few weeks ago, and talk about how it affected us personally, because it is personal. And I think one of the outcomes and the things that have come out of COVID is our lives have been blended. Many of you have met my dogs when the dogs are greeting the Amazon delivery truck for the 10th time that day. And I've met some of your kids. In fact, Claire, you were mentioning, you know, I think last night, different people meeting your kids. And you see this merging of our professional, our business lives, and our personal lives taking place in the context of COVID, and we've all got a COVID story. But one of the things I think that's important, and maybe we'll touch on this a little bit later, is we also have positive effects of COVID. For me personally, yes, I was stuck at home, I was starved for some of that face-to-face time with some of our team members, but also had great time with my family. We all got COVID at the same time, which was ideal, because then we were all stuck. Instead of waiting for it to do the daisy chain thing, we all had it at once, and we all got it out of the way, and we are fortunate in how we came through it. We have other members of our team that saw loved ones pass away in the midst of that and didn't even get to say goodbye. So I know there are challenges, there are also opportunities, and ways in which we've all had to grow. And one of the things for us personally is we've had to recognize the fact that we've had to build capacity within ourselves to be more resilient and deal with some of the challenges in front of us. We've seen on the far right side of the slide, you look at the energy crisis that's taking place here in Europe. And we'll talk a little bit more about this as we go through the conversation with Pasha. But what we've seen on both sides of the pond in terms of the energy crisis has been substantial. And it's made even worse by a war going on here. So we see these types of conflicts coming up and the geopolitical constraints and challenges that are coming in front of us. And yet all of you here in this room are still held your feet to the fire for promises of how are you going to deliver this stuff cost effectively? How are you going to meet the challenge of price volatility? How are you going to meet the challenge of climate change, net zero, carbon reduction, emission reduction in your companies? So despite all the stuff going on around, we're still expected to go in there and deliver on these other challenges, these global challenges that are affecting us. And then third in the middle, if you look at climate change and the impacts due to global warming, we have seen unbelievable progress and transition take place in the context of all these challenges at the same time. And for us, for a lot of us, it's very personal. We have personal incidents that we can point back to and see. And I was sharing over dinner last night one of my own. This past summer, one of the first times I traveled over here to Europe, team went up to went to Chamonix for a couple of days. Anybody been to Chamonix? Yes? Okay. Or thereabouts. And it's the first time that I've come to Europe and actually visited. So I come over here frequently. I live in the US. I come over here frequently, but it's always come over here, bust into a conference room, have meetings, meet with different people, and I get my energy from that, and I enjoy it, but I haven't really gone and visited very often and seen anything. Well, we were working, but we took a half day and hiked up at the foot of Mont Blanc. Now, I love the mountains. I grew up in Colorado for part of my growing up. I love the Rocky Mountains. But those Alps are unbelievable. To stand there and look at that mountain and the mountains around it was phenomenal. And we took a hike up. And whenever I go someplace, by the way, I have to take a cool dad photo for my kids. And so regardless of where we go, I've got to capture some piece of that. So we are hiking up here to a certain spot. And it's not quite as, it's a long drop, but I wedged my feet into the rock and it was windy. And then I refused to look down because it made me a little bit dizzy. But I stood there and just took it in and looking out across that valley. Well, what you see down below is Mer de Glace. Anybody familiar with Mer de Glace? The glacier? I might be pronouncing it poorly. But what you see down below, I'm pointing at the screen here, what you see down below is what's left of that glacier. Okay? And I'm standing there looking at this, and we had a glaciologist. We do have one in the room, but I'm going to leave it to her to confess who she is, so I'm not going to rat her out right here. We had a glaciologist with us that described what had been going on and what had happened. And he showed us some pictures from that same spot in 1900 and again in 2000. And I stood there looking down at that. When you look at the difference, it was unbelievable. And so it's receding by something like 2 kilometers in the last 20 years, and it just keeps pulling back, and the ice underneath keeps pulling back and getting less. Now, I'm not a climate denier, but oftentimes I stand there and I think, well, okay, it's always someplace else. You know what I'm saying? It's the impact is someplace else. It's not in my home. It's not in my backyard. And I'm just confessing that those are the things that might be running through my mind. But as I was standing there looking at that, you can argue about what caused it, and you can argue about what the solutions are. But as I stood there in that spot, I couldn't quite argue that it happened. And the effect of what's taken place over really just a handful of years. And to stand there and see that and hear the glaciologist, the guy was really sharp from Grenoble. Of course, anybody talking about that topic appears super sharp to me. But he was. And he described the process, and he had some tools to demonstrate what was taking place underneath. But when you stand there and look at that, and then you combine that with what we're seeing price-wise and the challenges in front of us in terms of volatility, I was very taken aback personally and looking at that. And Pasha, I think you've had some personal experiences as well. Why don't you?
Yeah, Steve, just tying off to what you mentioned, Not in My Backyard is a very famous American civil policy, right?
Yeah, exactly.
This picture actually is taken from my backyard. So this is on September 9th at 11 a.m. during the day. And it doesn't even do justice, the color saturation here, but it was essentially like a midnight sun. You couldn't see anything. This is due to forest fires in California. This is right outside of San Francisco, where I've lived for over 20 years, and never thought that, we had a 2-month-old baby where during pandemic we couldn't go outside because of the lockdowns, and then when those eased in the summer, we couldn't go outside because it was hazardous conditions. And while, thankfully, we weren't in the path of danger, but this you can still see the impacts in the atmosphere. And California is one of the most progressive states that's with the most progressive environmental policy by American standards. Mm-hmm. It probably doesn't say much in Europe, but still for us, it's a matter of pride where our tax money goes. But you're not shielded from this. This is a global, it's a global issue, and it's something that you experience firsthand. About a month later, we left California permanently because I no longer want to raise my family in such an environment. And not a proud moment of being like the first world climate refugee, but it's something that is going to be real. It's something that's going to happen everywhere. Now, I moved to France a couple of months ago, record temperatures that melted all of the small glaciers in top of the many alpine mountains, where for the first time in decades that has happened, and the snow still hasn't come back. It's having a hard time catching. It's droughts in the Nordics, which lowered the hydro reserves unprecedentedly. I was in Oslo right before moving to France, so it's like the issues are following, and the developed world no longer can say that, okay, it is not in our backyard, it is here. So we are living through this, where we are now, our generation is experiencing climate effects firsthand. It's driving policy changes, thankfully, finally. Too late, maybe, but hopefully not. I think we as a society have been able to rise to the occasion numerous times. You mentioned before the Kennedy space program.
Yeah.
And that was an inspiring initiative. Of course, it's between number of movies that I will let Steve talk about this, because I think you have a number of personal connections to it as well, but it inspired generations of scientists. We see the young activists, protesting and driving action at COP, at Davos, in major events, at G20. The change is here, it's happening, undeniable. The corporate world and the private sector in parts of the world has risen to the occasion. It hasn't been smooth, it hasn't been consistent, but we see it accelerating. So this is kind of the imperative and the opportunity that we have to act on this, hopefully, without further delay and at pace that the society requires. And now, if we think back to a couple of slides ago when you mentioned the two other once-in-a-lifetime unprecedented events that we're dealing with, so the confluence of those impacts, the pandemic that we thankfully haven't had for over 100 years, something that we learned how to live through, as well as geopolitical instability we thought that we left behind 70 years ago in Europe, is happening right now. Yesterday, everybody's phones fired up because a missile landed in Poland, and we thought we're going to be on the brink of triggering NATO Article 5 until, it fluctuates for sure. So it's something that we're living through is undeniably, rare. And this opportunity for us as leaders to act and change how we do things for the next decade, 2 decades, 3 decades, is probably a unique moment in time for us to capture. So.
But I think I love the way you show your picture from your backyard, because at the end of the day, it does get personal for all of us.
Yeah.
I was just going to comment, I think some of you may know Nisa Bradley, or one of our VPs on our team. And that could have been a photo, Nisa, this past year. I don't know if any of you heard about the forest fire or the wildfires in Boulder, Colorado, which is also one of the most sustainable communities and one of the most progressive with policies around the environment. We have a handful of our Boulder folks here. Nisa sold her home in one of the outskirts of Boulder and moved just a few miles away. And within, I think, 2 months is when the wildfires came through and completely wiped out the whole community, completely leveled, that she just moved out of. And so you look at this and go, it's difficult statistically to point to individual events and say, well, there's climate change because everything's connected. But you can't deny the fact that we're seeing more of this take place, and the impacts, whether it's from Pasha's backyard, whether it's Nisa's former backyard, or Steve's first experience in Chamonix, or any of you that have had similar experiences personally. And then you walk into your offices and have to deal with the challenge of the other side of it, which is what you do in business. And so maybe, Pasha, talk a little bit about what we're seeing here, if you would.
And this is something that you guys are living firsthand, but it's helpful to see in graphs and math and pictures the impact of volatility on energy prices in Europe. The percentages on the left-hand side in the graph are staggering. Just the prices and the rate of change that we're experiencing here in Europe has been, orders of magnitude greater than before. At the same time, we have this opportunity on the right-hand side where we have an inversion in the price of energy. Of renewable energy now costs oftentimes less than conventional energy. So our desire to deal with the volatility and uncertainty and kind of create business continuity out of the picture on the left-hand side, on the right-hand side, we have an amazing opportunity that, again, may be something that doesn't come around, something similar like this, very often. So it's very fascinating how we have a crisis, but at the same time, if we take a look and we plan correctly, we may be able to come out of this in a much better place.
What's interesting is we could take that same chart and probably change the time frame, and the chart would look exactly the same, but the y-axis would go from 0% to 100% or something like that. But for that y-axis to go to 2,750%, and you see that kind of volatility, staggering. I mean, we haven't seen anything like that.
Right. I mean, a lot of the prior crises are hidden in the noise that's on the chart on the left. Something that we're really worried about, something that newspapers are writing about, and the columnists and the journalists were talking about, you can't even see it because of on the graph anymore. It's absolutely fascinating. But in Europe, we're living this in the boardrooms, we're living this in executive meetings, we're living this in procurement conversations day to day. I'm curious, I mean, this is not an isolated issue to our continent because of the global interconnected markets. I mean, we have impacts through geopolitics and politics. I mean, this was a key issue in U.S. elections that are still not settled.
Yes.
For some reason.
We're going to drag it out as long as possible, by the way. So.
But I'm curious, Steve, from your perspective, how does our situation in Europe impact business community?
Well, I think with the EU taxonomy has a big impact on the U.S. We see it in the draft of the SEC rules that are being put in place. But I think the market forces of what's happening here in Europe has had a bigger impact. In other words, there are global companies that are situated here in Europe, and they can't just go apply these principles and make these promises about their footprint and not apply them globally. So I think for many of you in this room, the challenge is how do you do this around the world, not just how do you fit it into an EU taxonomy and a framework there, but then with new rules coming out in the US, it just spills over. And so I think the market, and really driven by the EU, has had a substantial impact around the globe. Okay, now the reporting requirements might be slightly different, but it doesn't really change the promises that your companies are making and the promises that you're gonna have to fulfill. So we've seen that spill over. Now, okay, we continue to have a bit of a circus politically in the US, and while it might be fun to watch, and I think we had another circus act last night from Mr. Trump when he declared that he's gonna run again, and at this point, I don't want to turn too political, but part of me just wants to go, okay, whatever, here we go again. And so on behalf of my country, I apologize for the circus that you're all going to observe over the next 24 months, and we'll see what comes out the other side. But when I dial back, and John Powers, John, you and I talked about this in 2016 as Renewable Choice was joining the team. And, we went through a similar situation staring at what's going to happen to clean tech, renewables, et cetera, in the U.S. when Trump comes into office, okay? And we thought the earth was going to cave in on it and everything was going to go away. And what ended up happening was a bit of an acceleration around purchase power agreements, renewable projects, to the point where today in the U.S., there's a real bottleneck of end users being able to get these deals done, in North America anyway, because of the high rate. Supply chain issues are challenging as well. But we didn't really see the slowdown that we thought we'd see. And so the good news is, individual crazy people can't really stop what is happening overall in the market and in progress. On the other hand, you got to pay attention to it because you don't know what different directions the policies may take. Specifically, we saw the passing of the Investment Recovery Act or Inflation Recovery Act that included long-term incentives that I have a difficult time seeing reversed in a new administration going forward. So we've seen a longer investment horizon now play out in the U.S. which I think is very positive for the change and the rate of the transition there. We also have not seen anywhere near the level of price volatility that you all have experienced here in Europe. So it's been on a very different scale.
Yeah, well, and unfortunately, system shocks like this, what we see on the left, can derail the best intention agendas for decarbonizations, could. At the same time, how do we make sure that we plan for this? And while we experience unprecedented confluence of events, as we mentioned, it's likely not going to stop. The pace of change in geopolitical turmoil and energy turmoil is probably may continue as we go forward, potentially exacerbated by the climate impact, anthropogenic climate effects on global economy and global supply chains. So how do we deal with the current volatility without changing our long-term path to a sustainable future, especially when, I mean, we can probably manage in our business plans for the next 3 to 5 years through this, but the path to decarbonization is a 15, 20, 30-year journey where even some of the technology hasn't been fully invented, or the price curves aren't there to where it's economically possible. So how do we cover the present situation without sacrificing the future generations? That was a good rhyme. I didn't practice that.
No. So, well, maybe you can talk a little bit about some of the other incidents and promises that, there we go.
Right, and so as you know, U.S. likes to talk about the Apollo program, right? We'll give them that.
Yeah.
But here is something much closer to us here in Europe is, who's familiar with the CERN Large Hadron Collider? Good. Hopefully everybody. It's been in the news for helping discover the fundamental, what's called a God particle. And the science that led to this, to discovery of the subatomic particle that gives every object mass, which is mind-boggling to think about what our science is currently doing, what kind of mysteries in the universe that we're able to unravel. That was a multi-decade journey that was fraught with, I mean, science was important. We had to invent new science. We had to invent new ways of doing physics that didn't exist just for the instruments to work. Very new electromagnetism principles had to be discovered in order to make those superconducting magnets go up to those types of energy levels. But what's even more impressive is that decades and decades of geopolitical negotiations took place where countries were brought together closely after Cold War, and this science cooperation was possible only after the global scientific community came together, invested the money, and gave up their individual aspirations. So U.S., for a long time, wasted billions and billions of dollars trying to compete with a CERN project to be the first, the biggest, and best, unsuccessfully, partly due to political changes and inability to maintain long-term vision on the budgets, but part of it is because we're stronger when we go together and we can tackle large and complex things together, and we demonstrate that we have a multi-year vision despite many challenges that can take place between now and then. So it's something that to me is close to heart. I studied physics in the past, so this is
we
one
never
of my favorite
would have guessed.
Story growing up. But I also wanted to bring back maybe briefly back to the Kennedy space program. And your personal story, which I really liked a lot.
It's well, I think, how many people remember the movie Hidden Figures? Anybody remember that? It's a story where a handful of women mathematicians that were doing the calculations by hand, if you saw the movie. You know, John F. Kennedy made a promise, okay? Not too unlike the promises that your companies or you've made around net zero targets or how you're going to accomplish this. You make the promise, and then you go back and you figure out how you're going to get there. Okay. Well, that's the promise John F. Kennedy made in the race with the Russians.
To make a good video about planting a flag on the moon, right?
Yes, exactly. Made a good video. Okay. All right, don't listen to the conspiracy theories, okay? But he made that promise, and he made it to the American people, and he said, we choose to do these things not because they're easy, but because they're hard. All right? Now, we're in the middle of this race to see who's going to get to the moon faster, and we know we're behind, we being the U.S. And he makes this promise. And in the movie, what I love is these women that are the mathematicians. There's a lot about that movie, by the way, that's really good and wrong when you look at how society at that time was treating people, not just of a different race, but gender also. And so here these women are, these mathematicians that are brilliant, are running all these calculations. And I love the scene in the movie when John Glenn is getting ready to get in that capsule, and he says, I'm not getting in there until she runs the numbers. Anybody remember that?
Yeah.
Okay, so There's a promise that's been made that we're going to the moon. This guy's putting his life on the line, and he's going to get in that capsule and go. And he turns and says, I'm not getting on board until she runs the numbers. She, now talk about pressure. She has to turn around and go back and run those numbers. Now, in real life, I think the numbers took a little bit longer than, you know, the 3 minutes it took in the movie. But she goes back and runs the numbers, and he gets in the capsule, and he goes up, and we can argue about whether he was really there or not in the video that was made. But I guess the point being that many of you are in a similar circumstance. Okay, maybe you're not running the numbers to go to the moon, and you're putting your life on the line that way. But your companies are making promises, just like mine are. Some of the promises we've made at Schneider Electric, we are not sure how we're going to get there. And in fact, even as we speak, there are team members of ours in this room that are also working with Schneider to try and figure out how are we going to accomplish these targets at 2025, 2030, 2040, et cetera, because that's like today after tomorrow. So we're not sure how we're going to address it either. And so in some ways, we're all in this boat together here over the next few days trying to figure this out and how we're going to face all these challenges. And so we're not going to get all the answers within the next few days, but we can certainly look at the challenges and better understand the challenges that our businesses are facing, that our overall economy is facing, okay, our teams are facing. I think it's really important to understand, you know, just as last night having dinner with a couple of team members of a particular company and listening to them talk about how they're dealing with some of the challenges within their own organization. We have the same thing. And so it's very important for us to be conscious of what our teams and our people are going through personally and how it's affecting, you know, what we do in our work and how we apply some of the same principles at home or in our communities or in our workspaces. And then for our planet, you think about how we're putting all of these different challenges together and how we're expected to come together and fulfill the promises that have been made, sometimes those promises that have been made by people other than us. We might have fed into them, but let's face it, most of these promises and objectives and goals have been set by a CEO, a CSO, or a CFO without full information. And so they're taking risks. Every one of us are taking risks because there is no sure thing that we're going to get to this. But the sure thing is that all of our organizations and our families and our communities are counting on people like us sitting in this room to come up with the great ideas of how we're going to address it and what we're going to do moving forward. It's not just about being sustainable from a clean perspective. It's also about how do we do this economically? How do we do this in an economically sustainable fashion that makes sense for our companies? How do we manage the price volatility? Right now, if you're in Europe, your bosses or your execs or your CEOs are asking as much about how you're going to deal with this cost increase as they are asking about how we're going to get green by 2025 or how we're going to be 100% renewable by such and such a year. You're getting it both ways. And I don't know about you, but there's some days I want to just say, hey, you can't have it both ways. Listen. But then I go ahead and have a glass of bourbon and go back and try and figure out, well, maybe there is a way to get there. Maybe there is something we can do. But meeting these challenges, you know, are going to take, it's going to, you know, you see on the slide here, it says the answer is resilience. Really, we all have to build a level of resilience into our own lives, into our plants. We want resiliency of supply. But at the end of the day, I think it takes courageous leadership to be able to step out there and not just make the promises, but fulfill the promises. It took courageous leadership on the part of John Glenn to get in that capsule, counting on, you know, these three women running the numbers. And it took tremendous leadership on the part of those three women. Katherine Johnson, I think, was the main character in the movie. It took tremendous leadership on her part and courage on her part to go run those numbers, come back and say, it's good. You're good to go. This is how it's going to work. That's what our companies are counting on us to do, is come back and say, you're good to go. This is how we need to do it, and we got to do it now. So I think it's key that we address what do these challenges look like? What are the front? And I want to encourage all of you, as you're here this week, to take the time to learn from each other. So, Kim... last night, you said a key word over dinner, that to stand up here and assume that myself or Pasha are experts on this would be a mistake. I'd like to say otherwise, but I think we all have to approach this with a spirit of humility, where we come into this room or we come into the breakout sessions and we go into it with a spirit of humility that we need to learn, because this stuff is moving so fast, it's changing every day. There's something new that's going to happen. As Pasha said, you know, who would have thought we'd wake up to a missile landing in a country that's not involved in that war? We wouldn't have expected that. So there are going to be unexpected things coming up and taking place that we're going to have to learn from. And we've got to approach it with that spirit of humility. I love the way you use that word. In order to really learn, to be learners. And so I would encourage you, spend the time with each other, spend the time with our team members, but take this opportunity, this one day, to learn and experience some of this and also feed in. Because there are experiences that you have that other folks here in this room can benefit, you know, from as well. So you see the three words on the slide: explore, ask, and challenge. I would totally encourage you to do all of that. Just please do it to Pasha, if you would, and make his, you know, we got to have a little bit of onboarding for him as well. So
onboarding or hazing, one of those.
Yeah, either one. That's it. but I want to thank you all for attending. I hope you do get a lot out of the day today. If nothing else, you know, it's something other than a video, a person on the other side of the video screen, and we can enjoy the time together and learn. So thank you. And I think Sarah is probably up here next.
Thanks so much.